Okay, so let's start. So, okay, I went to the Embedded Linux conference in France. It's not July, I typed wrongly. Okay, it's in October. Sorry, typo, see now I realize. Okay, yeah, so this conference, right, is not just a conventional Linux conference. It is a conference with an emphasis on embedded systems. Hence the name Embedded Linux Conference. Okay, yeah, okay, it's next. And it has 10 plus tracks, and it lasted for 3 days. And I try to summarize it in less than 20 minutes for you. Okay, I'll try. So I just pick up a few key talks. Okay, so the first keynote talk was given by a Linux kernel developer and a fellow from Linux Foundation. He basically gave a summary of the CPU bugs, like Meltdown, Spectre, File, and Zombieland. Yeah. So this is a key area of his talk where he mentioned that when the CPU bugs were first discovered, right, Microsoft, Apple, and major Linux vendors were first to be notified. But Debian was not notified till 48 hours before the public release. And the reason was because Debian is not considered a company. And despite the fact that 80% of Linux installations, minus Android, they use Debian-based distributions. They are very sad. Okay, so they say that even though these bugs were announced like 2 years ago, right, there are still bugs being found. There are bugs in the security fixes and they're still fixing it. Okay, so he said that we should always update our kernel and our BIOS. Okay, yeah. That's his words, okay? And don't just update security patches by CVE, because not everything has a CVE, okay? And a normal patch may not be known as a security patch 2 years later. A bug now may not be deemed as a security problem until years in the future. So he says, update everything. Yeah. He say, not I say one. Okay, so another talk that I attended was called NutX for Embedded Linux Developers. Okay, so NutX, right, is a POSIX compliant real-time OS. Okay, so you can think of it as something like FreeRTOS. So it supports many microcontrollers, a small footprint, and runtime memory. Okay, so the key thing for this OS is that it's POSIX compliant. Its aim is to make app development easy for Linux developers. So you can basically write your app and test on Linux before porting it to a microcontroller. Right. So this guy is a speaker from Sony, and he said that Sony has used NutX in many of their audio products, like wireless headphones, recorders, and music players. Okay, so something to consider. Okay, so next talk, safety versus security. This guy, he basically tried to give us a viewpoint from both sides of the table. Okay, so what's the difference between these two cultures, right? So let's look at safety. So safety people will say that code must be proven and certified, and the bug likeliness goes down with time. The longer you don't see a bug, the less likely there's a bug in the system, right? And a known bug with no consequences should be ignored. If your bug doesn't cause you any problem, don't care about it, right? And upgrade only is a last resort, because upgrading something has the potential of breaking something. But the security people will say that you must react quickly the moment you discover a security bug, and threat models will evolve and adapt, okay? So all bugs are potential exploit, and you must fix it quickly. And therefore, you must always use the latest version. So in conclusion, right, so any change is a risk and needs to be justified, the safety people say. The security people say any bugs are potential security weakness and must be fixed. Okay, so again, there's these two clashes already. Okay, so that is it for the high level view. How does this apply to the embedded world, right? Okay, so the safety people will say, right, okay, if you want to do an upgrade, your upgrade must be robust and you must deal with failures on your own, because you have all these issues. You don't have access to your product. It's not like a server where you can easily access it, right? Your product is somewhere far away, maybe. And let's say that backblocks, something wrong with your file system or your disk, right? You have conflicting configuration files, invalid user configuration, all this that may prevent your system from booting properly. And not to mention your kernels sometimes has to be upgraded. And some systems can't be stopped. It's not like you can just reboot your server anytime, right? Some mission critical stuff, the moment you reboot, you may lose some functionality. Your old hardware can't be phased out easily. Once deployed there, it takes a lot of resources to switch the hardware out. And the last point is that deployment time is controlled by the user. You cannot just anytime say, I want to stop and upgrade. It's determined by whether your user says you can turn off the system or not. Okay, for the security people, This is how they will think, right? Your physical access, you can't be restricted. It's not like your data center, you can restrict it via lock and key. Certain things like your bootloader attacks, your JTAG attacks, all this, they can affect your system, right? If your attacker has access to the hardware. And each thing is, there's no upgrade culture. Because you need to see where embedded systems are being deployed at. Who are the people that develop this, right? So for example, hardware makers. The guy gave an example of aircons. So when you design an aircon, you sell it to customer, you just leave it. You don't really need to update it. But the moment you put an embedded computer inside there, you need to take care of updates. And these people may not have the mentality to do it correctly. Or people who work in startups, who may not have a long-term maintenance team because the startup may not survive long enough for that. Okay, no offense to anybody who works startups here, okay? Okay, so what is the solution? So one way is you avoid the problem or put it nicely, don't care about it. Okay, why? Because his point is not all products are safety critical. So if your products are not connected to internet and you can guarantee that no one else can access it, then it's fine really. Right, but you still need a robust upgrade system in case you find really genuine bugs in it. You may need to accelerate recertification. Like you need to make sure that if you want to do an update, there's a quick way to certify all your upgrades are basically safe, they don't break your product. You can try to isolate certain things like containers, hypervisors, the hardware separation one. So maybe you can, like for example, separate out the mission critical part into a separate microcontroller. So while your main system is doing upgrade, the microcontroller can run the mission critical function separately. And just have a culture okay, to make sure you plan an end of life for your products. Right. So this one, a lot of people, they do not really think about it so much. Like make sure you start off with the end in mind. Okay, this is another talk to reduce the boot time reduction techniques. Okay, so this guy is trying to reduce the boot time of his BiggerBone Black. Okay, so he has these functions. He has an LCD, a webcam, and a micro SD card, basically to record something and to display it. Okay, so he said, how fast can he reduce the boot time? So his initial boot time was 9.45 seconds. Okay, so this was his principles. Okay, you start by optimizing things that won't reduce your ability for future measurement. So you may need to instrument the measurement of a boot time. And but you don't want to basically go and optimize it such that you until you cannot even measure this. You need to make sure that you keep your measurement tools until the very last minute. Okay? Another one is to try to keep to slower storage. So the example that he gave in his talk was to deliberately use a very slow SD card. So it amplifies the boot time. So he can easily see that, okay, certain things take this much longer to start. If you use a very fast SD card, right, you can't really see a difference. Okay? And start from last pass of boot time means you finish by the kernel at the end by the bootloader. You start from the apps that you start and work backwards. Okay? So I will skip right to the end of his talk and just show his summary slide. Yeah, so this is, you can see that the biggest one is the silent kernel. Basically disable all the messages. The tracing one, this one is actually the instrumentation. So you can see that the instrumentation itself will take up like 550 milliseconds. So it takes a lot of time, but you should do it at the last lap. Okay? So you can take a look at all the others that optimization that he has. Okay, you have to know more, just go and look for his talk. Okay, so Linus Torvalds, yeah, finally see this famous guy. Okay, no need to intro who is he. Okay, so I like this exchange. Okay, so the other guy is open source officer at VMware asked him, what do you do in your job as kernel maintainer? Then he say, Linux says, I read lots of email and sometimes say no. You need someone with the background to say no. Occasionally, I'll send out pseudo code as suggestion, but I don't write code anymore. So Doug said, I think you just deglorify your job. Yeah. So he's more of a managerial role now. He doesn't write any code now already. Okay. But of course, this exchange lasted, I think, for half an hour. Yeah, so you can watch the videos, they're all online. Okay, so this one, another speaker, also about boot time optimization, but closer to the system D side, rather than the lower level kernel aspects. Okay, so just a quick intro, init. So init is basically something that will start after the kernel has started and it starts all your stuff, okay, and configures everything. So system D is in a way something like a replacement, but it's not just an init. He emphasized system D is a way of life. It takes over. It takes over freaking everything. Okay, so you can see these are the the stuff that is yeah, it takes charge of. Okay, so okay, so this slide, this talk is very long, but the idea is she was trying to point out is that systemd, although it's used for servers, right, you cannot just take a configuration that is optimized for server and then dump it to your embedded system and hope that it works the same way. Okay, so okay, but the general principle is still the same. You leave out tasks you don't need and you change the order of tasks. Of course, this high level principle, to actually execute it, right, you need to benchmark your system, right? So you benchmark with something called systemd analyze, which actually I did not know about this until I attended his talk. Yeah, so you can take a look. So you just run this command, then you can see roughly like each service takes how long to start. Then you can optimize accordingly. Okay. Yeah, as usual, you want to know more, just see his talk. This one I found was quite funny. Linux IKC in the 21st century. So Wolfram Tseng, right? He's a freelance consultant, but he consults mostly for Renesas, a chip maker. And so on his sideline, he's a I2C maintainer for Linux. So he started off with what can go wrong with I2C, right? Okay, so he puts it very simply, like, okay, the bus spec has not changed since 1982. It's not rocket science. So the drivers are relatively simple, right? Okay, but he points out these three points. Okay, it's a flyby subsystem. Okay, so why did he say that? It's because people mostly don't care about it until it impacts them. Okay, and mostly used by embedded purposes only. So the number of people who are concerned with I2C is further narrowed. And the most dangerous thing is largely maintained in spare time of one maintainer, which is himself. Okay, so this was the point that he made. So one day he said he was quite sick. So he emailed to a few people. He said, I've been tied to a bed for a few days, not in a condition to work on I2C. So I think it's annoying, sure, but no catastrophe. However, it shows that I'm the single point of failure for I2C patches, what I don't like. So like I said before, I'm open to group maintenance. If you think you are a reliable candidate, please get in touch with me. Okay, so he sent to a few people, and only one guy replied. And guess what the reply is? Okay, I show you. Get well soon.
Wow, this one. I think you have to point out that this I2C maintainer is kernel space, not user space.
Oh, okay.
So it's
okay.
Not the ones that you use for your hobby.
Oh, okay.
Those
okay.
Are user space I2C drivers.
Oh, okay.
This one is kernel space, which is a lot harder.
A lot harder, okay. Okay, need to emphasize. Yeah, true, need to emphasize. Where they are, right? Oh yeah, Linux kernel I2C maintainer, okay. So this was a point that he will raise that was quite a new thing and complex, because I2C is not just, it's not static. So this was an example he gave, I2C encapsulation with multiple gigabit multimedia serial links, very long. So the point was saying that some new chips being developed, they have this, I2C normally is meant for very close communication, right, between electronic components, right, but people have used I2C for this. They go and encapsulate it with some GMSL links, which normally used in coaxial cables, and they pipe it to some far away camera sensors, for example. It's different for your typical use case of I2C. And the thing is, all these are the same I2C addresses. So it becomes very hard to communicate. And then the maker of this chip proposed to have a dynamic I2C address and allocation. Something like your DHCP server. So suddenly, this one is acting like, I need to hand out I2C addresses. So it's very strange. Okay, the point that he's trying to make is that clearly cases where Linux is not prepared for this. This was his exact words on his slides. Okay, so he detailed some API changes. I don't really use them, but the key point is that some breaking changes, right? He purposely changed the parameters to break people's code during compilation. Yeah, to force you to read about them. Because if you just change the API without changing the parameters, your code compiles fine, right? Well, you may face problems. Your code will suddenly you compile properly but suddenly fail. Then another API that he also mentioned was something like a dummy device. Okay, so he says that now the current drivers, I think you can only use one address, but some I2C devices, they may use two addresses. So the current hack is to use an API called new dummy device. But when if your driver uses this, right, nobody else knows who reserves this I2C address. So he proposes that people use the new API with let you supply the name parameter, so they know which driver uses it. Okay, I left 4.5 minutes. Okay, good. That's in time. So I have a I joined this conference closing game. Yeah. So this one is quite unique. Okay. So basically, at the end of the conference, everyone will stand up, and then if you answer the conference quiz correctly, right, you sit down. Then if the last few people who remain standing will get prizes. Okay. So you can see this one of these questions that you can see. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so the first thought program machine was a loom that used sponge wooden cuts automatically with fabric designs. This machine was invented in France. So green is true or red is false? So which one do you think it is?
France, yeah.
Yeah, it's true, it's true. Okay, so you can see the green and red cuts, right? Okay, so you basically erase. Yeah, so the a unique point that I found interesting was they said at the start, right, when they first started this conference series, both cuts were of the same size. So they had a problem with colorblind people. Yeah, because the color could not differentiate. So now they make the green cut bigger than the red. Okay, so then this interesting question. Which continent has the highest percentage of Linux users?
Asia.
Asia is what?
Percentage, it means percentage
per
population. That's interesting.
Yeah, percentage, why? Yes, that's asking the right question. Yes.
Because it would be dependent on the population otherwise, right?
Yes.
So it's Asia, of course. It's percentage of the population of the
continent.
All Linux users are population of the continent.
Of the continent, yeah.
Of the continent.
Yeah, of the continent, yeah.
Populized population.
Ne? Highest percentage.
Is it Europe?
Europe or North America?
Continent, yeah, so far all wrong.
Wait, because Android is Linux.
Let's discount Android from this. Throughout the entire conference, right, they keep minusing Android. Yes, right. Yes.
Good point.
So the percentage is roughly 12%.
Sure.
Because a lot of scientists are working there.
All penguins from the
very trick question, right? So you see, there's green and red, none of the above. Wow, this question killed a lot of people.
Trick question.
Trick question. Okay, so I can come to the closing talks. Closing thoughts of this. So, there were 10 tracks. So even I personally couldn't even attend majority of the talks. I attended maybe 10% of the talks. So, you can take a look at the videos of the conference. I'm not sure if they have been made public. Let me try. Is it playlist? Oh shit. Oh sorry. Okay, I'm not sure whether this playlist is public yet, because it was originally sent to all those who attended the conference, but it was all here lah. You can take a look. How many? 88. Yeah, a lot of it. Okay, so you can just take a look. If I'll post it on Hackware later, then they're all in English. Yeah, but everything is in English here. Yeah. Okay, so the interaction with people. So I find it quite useful to attend conferences because you can talk to people and then you get recommendations. For example, the NutX talk, right, was because someone recommended to me. And I knew about the existence of open source consultants because someone recommended to me. Okay, I didn't know about open source consultants before, like people that help you to upstream your drivers, for example, right? Okay, so that is, I have 10 seconds, so that's all, just in time.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So next up we have